Thank you for the. Oops, it says recording in process. So should I just continue? What I would like to do is, I'm not sure I will give a more optimistic view, but maybe a more blended view, looking at challenges, but also at opportunities of democracy in pandemic times, and the way in which these ideas build upon previous wave of social movements that challenged previous emergencies. So I will present especially the reflection on the ways in which participation and deliberation can address some of the limitations of representative liberal forms of democracy that have developed through a series of emergencies, crises, challenges. I'm sure you have covered some of those in the past. I want to reflect a bit on those in the present that are already, however, very much connected with the previous type of development. So what I want to do is to present, first of all, what do we mean by participatory and deliberative democracy, just to give a background, but then to reflect on the ways in which crisis of representative democracy can be contrasted or resisted through the development of different conceptions of democracy, given the fact that democracy has always been considered as having different qualities, and so the potential for balancing in different forms these different qualities. So first of all, what did it happen with pandemic times? We expected that pandemic times, especially in the period of the lockdown, would have stopped some potentials for social movements to mobilize in the street and present therefore different conceptions of democracy, calling for participation and constructing channels of deliberation. To a certain extent, so that 2020 would stop the wave of protest that had characterized 2019, from the demonstrations of Fridays for Futures to the demonstrations of Non Una Di Meno, Ni Una Menos, of the feminist movements, of the so-called fourth wave of feminist movements. Well, the impression was these movements will be suspended during the pandemic time. And although there were certainly challenges in going to the streets in the typical forms of protest, especially during the first phase of the pandemics, what we saw was rather a multiplication of forms of protest, so much so that some of the mainstream media said it is a new age of protest. And we had protest on different topics, of course, especially visible on the topics that were brought to the fore from the pandemic crisis itself. So, protesting for public health was very strong. This is a picture from the United States, where there was also a contraposition between the sort of Trump supporters denying the pandemics and nursery and workers in the health system defending the rights of the patients and the rights to public health. But in different countries, it happened in different ways, and also not only involving workers, but also involving citizens that, for instance, organized very original forms of protest on the balcony in support of public health, in the beginning more to express solidarity to those who were struggling in hospitals, but then also to claim a more investment in public health system. But the type of protest were also bridging different, the type of protest, yes, were bridging different issues that had already become relevant before the pandemics. For instance, it became quite evident since the very beginning that the spreading and the effects of the COVID-19 was also stronger and so related with pollutions and with transformations, challenges for the environment, in particular to climate change. This is the strikes for climate that happen, for instance, in Germany through different forms. Then the ones that we were accustomed to see in 2019, but still represented many citizens who all along the world stated that it was important to devise deep transformations in the model. There were a lot of protests for workers' rights, because the pandemics had sort of transformed also the perceptions of the value of some types of professions, of some type of workers. For instance, the definitions of the workers that were indispensable pointed to the relevance of professions that had been considered as secondary and not worth high salary, but it became very visibly central for the survival of society. And what the pandemic also made more evident was the fact that many of these workers had very limited rights. So that from the riders to the drivers who helped us survive the lockdown, precarity had imposed not only low salary and bad working conditions, but also over exploitation that workers started to protest against. And there were protests also more in general for the defense of citizenship rights, also in terms of social rights. This is a protest of on the Labor Day of the Greek trade unions that invented ways to be present in the streets and to protest, calling for a different conceptions also of the state and for a return of investment. And many protests, and this is the point I wanted to reach, were directly addressing also the issues of democracy. It was not just protesting for changes in policies or for better rights on the workplace, but also for a different conceptions of the ways in which citizens could participate. And also there was a resistance to the way in which some governments in particular, the challenge in general for democracy to develop and to keep some standards during the period of the emergency. And this is something I want to address before moving to the ways in which social movements can help keeping democratic qualities by emphasizing especially deliberation and participation. So, which were the challenges that social movements faced in terms of quality of democracy in the periods of the pandemics? Some of the challenges were long-lasting. So already in 2003, a book, substantially an essay, that became very resonant in different countries was Colin Crouch's book on post-democracy. And what he pointed at was the fact that even if keeping the formal characteristics of the democracy with the weakening of political parties, with the transformations of the capacity of the states to invest and reduce inequalities, democracy was losing a lot of its previous capacity. So a statement by Colin Crouch that I often cite is, as state functions are devolved to private actors, the state loses its capacity to do things that it used to do quite well. So the what he described was a sort of return to pre-democratic conditions in which political and economic elites tended to control powers, while the functions of democracies in terms of reductions of inequalities and so interventions in improving the rights of the citizens have been lost. And this he addressed in particular thinking about neoliberal type of policies as characterized by deregulations, privatizations, and liberalizations that he singled out as effectively reducing the capacity of the state to do things that the state could do quite well in the past. And the effect of this lack of capacity to intervene in order to support citizens' rights was effectively the development of the problems about which Colin Crouch has been reflecting a lot also later on, which is how much inequalities can democracies survive. So once democracies have reduced their capacity to intervene, and so in the pandemic we can say once democracies have reduced the investment in public health and in other ways to reduce inequalities, how able they will be to face the type of dissatisfaction, decline of legitimacy, and so on. So this was a long-lasting challenge. Another challenge, but also an opportunity, was pointed at by another scholar who reflected a lot on the development of democracy, Pierre Rosanvallon, French this time, and he developed the idea that is present in a lot of reflections on in political science and sociology on the development of democracy, that is the fact that democracy do not require only elections, but also a series of other type of institutions that he calls institutions of counter-democracy, not in the sense that they are against democracy, to the opposite, in the sense that they help controlling, making accountable the institutions of democracy. And this is a statement I wanted to point it at. Already Rosanvallon in 2006, so well before the pandemic, stressed the fact that he wrote, if the electoral democracy is challenged, its capacity are evidently reduced, the democracy of expressions, implications, and intervention, which is the way in which it defines participations and deliberations, become more and more relevant. So what he says is, faced to a decline of support for representative institutions and especially reduction of trust in institutions. What one needs to do is to develop a democracy for which mistrust is a resource rather than a challenge. That is, one needs to construct channels of access for the citizens and to multiply the potential checks and balances. In fact, considers as important actors of counter-democracy, not so much the parties, but mainly social movements, civil society organizations, and also the mass media, the Habermasian public spheres, and so on. The problem, this I will not address now. The problem with the deployment of the type of solutions that Rosanne Vallon suggested and noted were ongoing emerged with the pandemics because of some characteristics that sociologists and political theorists like, for instance, Jonathan White have described as states of emergencies. So Jonathan White had been looking at the previous moment of big crisis, the financial crisis with what economists and sociologists alike have called the Great Recession. And yet, pointed at some elements that I think fit very well also with the type of institutional developments during pandemic time. So a centralization of the decisions rather than the check and balances that Rosanne Vallon pointed at as especially relevant. The lack of transparency of the decisions, so situations in which the very visibility of decision making became less and less open for the citizens. But also he stressed the fact that in a state of emergencies, being them financial crisis or pandemic crisis, a challenge for democracy is the claim that there is no alternative. So the claim that during a pandemic time, it is up to the scientists to define the solutions and that these solutions are not subject to political decisions. This is a problematic for democracy because it denies the very fundamental issues of the political content of decisions. During the pandemic time, as during the financial crisis, there was the claim that we need total solidarity, that there are no divergent issues, that even talking about political choice is a negative instance. So typically, Generale Figliuolo said to the president of the regions, decisions are not political, just do what the state tells you to do. So denial of political choice, while instead political choice were extremely relevant because the higher the challenge, the more relevance for the life of the citizens were these choices. Also, reductions of the arguments that were considered as legitimate. This is what scholars of communication science, communication sociologists pointed at. The public spheres was occupied by only by a topic, and the type of arguments that were accepted were constantly limited and reduced. but also reductions of put arguments, but it is wrong. I wanted to put actors that were considered as legitimate. So there was more and more a focus on the legitimacy of actors that owned and could claim public expertise, but also a reduction of the legitimation given to normal citizens to make suggestions or claims that addressed pandemic time. And of course, the reduce of space for spaces for contestation. So, of course, the social movements live a lot in the streets, live a lot in the squares, and the type of capacity to do this was strongly reduced from the lockdown. And it was reduced for a long period. So it is more than 1 year of state of emergency, which means the importance of creating spaces for institutional spaces for deliberation and participations have been limited. So there is more and more a challenge to the ways in which institutional democracy has developed. This is a picture which comes from 2011 in Spain, but it's also the challenge that democracy lives in terms of institutions lives today. The idea, they call it democracy, but in reality, this post-democracy has been emptied out and the state of emergency has at least frozen a lot of the components that make for a functioning democracy. So I think that this is the challenge. What I would like to point at is that in reality, democracy is not only institutional democracy, but it is many different qualities that are stressed in many different ways. And this here, Rosan Vallon is again useful because what he pointed at is the importance of considering the different spaces in which democracy is practiced, the different actors that allow for the functioning of democracy, not only through electoral accountability, but also through the possibilities for citizens, civil society organizations, social movements, and so on to be accountable towards the citizens. And so also the idea that a great scholar of democracy, Robert Dahl, called really existing democracy, have been always characterized by different types of institutions. Some of them were based on delegation of tasks to the representatives. Some of them were based on the principle of the majority wins, but there have always been also instruments, institutions that belong to different type of conceptions of democracy. For instance, referendums are characteristics of direct forms of democracy. Forms of participations have been multiplied during a wave of protests that have promoted forms of participations in the schools, in the neighborhoods, in many public services and so on. But also more recently, experiments like the participatory budgeting or public debates testify for the combination in a really existing democracy of institutions following the logic of electoral accountability delegation and majoritarian votes, but also other institutions that instead follow different type of conceptions. And so respond to different democratic qualities. And my suggestion following Rosanne Vallone is also that when the institutions of representative democracies are the most challenged, then we need to reflect also about other democratic qualities. And here I want to point that these two democratic qualities that I also put in the title of my presentations, one is participation. So democracy has been claimed to be democracy of the modern, a representative based especially on representative institutions, but even those who have stressed this point of delegation and representations, like for instance Bertrand Manin, have mentioned that representation is based on the capacity of people to express their opinions, also beyond type of electoral elections and type of electoral accountability. But also many scholars, from Carol Pateman to many others, have stressed the importance of creating more and more challenges of more and more channels of participation that can also be extended to several realms of citizens' life, not only the parliaments or the equivalent at the local level, but also, she said, create as many spaces of participations as there are public decisions to make, as there are decisions that affect the individuals. So my main point is participation is always necessary, also because there is no logic arguments that support the idea that the delegates are always right. Delegates needs to be in contact with the societies. In the traditional model of democracy, this happened through political parties. With the decline of political parties, the need for other channels of participation emerges. So conceptions of equal participations, of inclusive participation are embedded in these conceptions of participatory democracy that has been also historically connected with the really existing representative democracy. But there is another element that I want to stress that is very important in the development of normative thinking about democracy, and it is the idea of deliberation, which has emerged with Jürgen Habermas' reflections of the quality of the discourse and has developed then with the feminist critique of Habermas, stressing the importance of creating several arenas in which the main task for democratic citizens is not just voting, but it is to create environment, discursive environments, in which citizens could form their preferences. That is conceiving democracies not just as a market in which citizens and other actors arrived with their own interests and preferences already developed, but more deeply considering democracy as a space in which democratic citizens can interacting, construct their own identities, preferences, and definitions of interest, orienting their decisions towards the public good. So creating schools of democracies in which the citizens could be transformed from individuals in a mass into citizens endowed with rights and capable of deciding on their rights. So this is a definition that I developed on the basis of this type of qualities, participatory and deliberative democracies, under conditions of equality, inclusiveness and transparency, a communicative process based on reasons, this is Habermasian good argument, is able to transform individual preferences, but especially to create collective identities and to reach decisions oriented to the public good. This is clearly a normative definitions than the ways in which empirically existing institutions approach these ideas is another matter. But the main point is to stress that not only Habermas, but also many other authors pointed at the importance of democracy is not voting, the importance of democracy is debating. And in fact, this is also a conception that is included in many formal institutions of democracy. Think about the parliament, in which the important moment that voting comes at the end, but what is important is the possibilities through good quality of the discourse to reach a public good. So, last part, and I will try to be brief here, is how can social movements in pandemic times perform this type of democratic functions that institutions, as I mentioned, in state of emergencies have reduced capacity to address. What did we see in pandemic time? First of all, we saw a lot of protest using sometimes also innovative repertoires, digital and non-digital. On the digital side, we had live streamed protests, digital rallies, virtual marches, and online petitions. But we also had more physical forms of actions, from pot banging, collective performances of protest songs from balcony, or forms of resistance in for workers, like calling sick and other forms of reducing the challenges on the work. And there were sort of adaptations of the traditional forms of protest, the march, to the conditions of the pandemic. Car caravans in Israel or bike caravan in Slovenia, walks out, distance demos, sit-ins, or if you think about the Black Lives Matter movements, sort of open mic sit-ins that allows the citizens to express their personal feelings and ideas. Boycott strikes, rent strikes. So we are doing research on this. And what we saw is that pandemic is a moment of intensifications of this type of struggles. What we see in the media very often is just the no mask demonstrations or no vax demonstrations. But if we look especially at the local pages of the newspapers or also other databases on the web, we see multiplications of the protest in the street. But what I want to stress is that it was not just protest. What social movements, organizations on the progressive side did was also a lot of what has been called new mutualism or direct social actions. So organizing sort of services, help, solidarity activities, distributions of food and medicines, the productions of healthy food, or the productions of medical equipment, giving shelter to women that were living in violent domestic environment, to migrants that remain without support, to the homeless that had often no place to go, especially in the pandemic. And the characteristics of this type of interventions was that they were not just oriented towards charity, but also to try to develop an alternative visions. And finally, you have the development of alternative knowledge. So a lot of things that activists did during the pandemic was to use the web and for those especially who had access to it, to try to develop reflections, collect informations on some aspects that were especially dramatic during the pandemic, but were not covered from the media. So from the unequal effect of the pandemics on different intersectional inequalities to the challenges also in terms of democratic participations and so on. So approaching the end of this presentation, which were the main legacy, or we cannot really talk of a legacy because the pandemic time are not completely over yet, but after 1 year, one can see what remain or what is developing in this moment. In terms of organizational forms, many of these activities were extremely decentralized. So it was based on local organizations, neighborhood support, through a process of coordinations that often involved a group of friends or colleagues. But with also development of networking. So the challenge for these groups was not only providing, for instance, for solidarity and support, but also reconstituting social relations, social ties that were perceived as particularly at risk during a pandemic, especially related with an infectious disease that tend to create fears and divisions in the population, scapegoating, and we have also seen this during the pandemic. So reconstituting these ties and also sort of reactivations of different groups. So what we saw was that very quickly, almost on the pressure of the emergency and the needs, formal groups like emergency, for instance, converged with squatted centers, but also very horizontal groups of citizens to produce immediate type of help, but also to develop more broad type of conceptions and claims and bridging solidarity with advocacy. What we also saw was that there is more and more of a framing of what scholars of social movements have called frame bridging. So the connections of different frames, which also means the connections of different movements, for instance, on public health, on social inequalities, but also on the women's, on migrants, with Black Lives Matters, we saw all these elements together, the environmental challenges and so on. With some innovations, especially around the idea of the commons that has been linked with the idea of caring, that is sort of an emerging frame during the pandemic. And finally, what's the threat and opportunities at this point? Is a clear threat, and this became more and more visible, is the ways in which all the problems that I've mentioned with the lack of capacity of democracies to perform what they claim they could perform, that is improving citizens' rights, become more and more evident. So one of the threats for the movements was having to confront and potentially intervene on the ways in which these inequalities were dramatically affecting the life of many of the social groups they wanted to support. And the threats came also from the state of emergencies in a situations in which there was growing limitations of the possibilities to keep governments accountable in, as I mentioned, state of emergencies. There is, however, another opportunity that have been stressed a lot in reflections on the way in which wars affect the development of citizens' rights. And one of the reflections developed, for instance, by Charles Tilly is that what he said was that if states make wars, wars make states. So that's the conflictual moments have been not automatically, but under the pressures of social movements, often followed by an enlargement of rights. So typically after the Second World War, you have the disenfranchising of women, the expansion of some conceptions also of the social states. And research on other pandemics, for instance, the Spanish flu, indicated also that pandemic open discursive opportunities in the sense that they make the need for political interventions more pregnant, more relevant. I just want to close now and so to leave some time for the discussions. I leave a question mark about political opportunities, which is also a question that is particularly relevant in the Italian case. So threats and opportunities are mediated through political type of development, contextual characteristics and so on. And Italy is a particular type of context in which we have now to address the crisis, a government which is made practically by all political parties but one, and in which all those claims of state of emergencies have been very strongly defended. So it is a government that deny political choices and make also for an open challenge to the very ideas that politics is about conflicts, is about interest and so on, presenting a sort of common destiny, which the way in which the pandemic has developed really challenges, because while public discourse have been often stressing the pandemics as showing the weaknesses, that we are all on the same boat, in reality, what we have seen is that the pandemics has built upon inequalities and increased them. So how the political opportunities will develop for movement and to which extent these movements will be able to save democracy, it is an open question for the discussions to go a little bit more in depth in that, but of course also for the future to tell us. For the moment, I would go back to close to another pictures of 2011 and the stressing that democracy is not a spectator sport. So it means it's not something that can be limited to electoral accountability, but requires participations and also conflicts and the recognitions of democracy as a way to address conflicts rather than denying them. And I will stop here.
Thank you very much, Donatella, for this very interesting and question opening speech and lecture. I think that, it's a great opportunity for us and for the students to discuss the many issues you pointed out and that are at the core of our reflection in those days. So I think it's a really good way to close our series of seminars and addressing question on democracy and how it works and how it can work in the next future. So I would open the floor to the students first, even if I would have many questions, but I leave them for the last part of the discussion if there is time. And they can, the students and the people that are attending to this lecture, they can both ask questions through the chat or raise their hands and we can make them speak, isn't it, Antonio?
Right, so what my suggestion is that it's very easy if anyone, I hope more than one, would mm-hmm. like to make a question, to ask a question, just please raise the hand as usual and then I will give you the possibility to speak directly, I think, with Donatella instead of chatting your question.
We need an icebreaker.
May I just, before students, let's see if there is anyone would like to ask, because I also have a couple of questions. So let me start. So I hope that then I'll be less shy. So let me with a more controversial view, so that I'm less pessimistic. And the reason why I'm less pessimistic with respect to your view is that actually, let me say, in your picture, so there is something or someone who is almost absent, which is actually the internet. So actually, the first challenge is actually, so you stress a lot the role of actually political participation through actually participation protests in the streets. But my controversial argument is that actually this is not anymore the case. So perhaps was in the 70s, the 80s, but now opinion, and we need the well-informed voters, so it's clear. So they create on in the internet. So and this is the special guest that was not mentioned in your talk. So, and this is actually a bit of, and I think that was also actually the one of the risk, and we have discussed a lot about populism, how actually these new actually tools and how you might actually understand opinion and to weight opinion in the internet. That we are better able to understand the value of opinion expressed in person, perhaps. But on the same way, so this was a great opportunity because if we had a shock, we have a great technological shock. So people now are much better and more informed and use actually internet and technological devices for learning, etc. So there is not only an optimistic view in the sense that there was also a technological shock that is relevant because actually of the relevance of the internet also to form political opinion. And second question, so different question again to try to be, say, slightly more optimistic in the sense that's true what you said about the pandemic, the emergency state and the reduction also of the political debate that was focused on a single topic. But on the same time, there's a great way, so what economists say, like yardist competition. So we have observed the same shock that has hit in many countries, on even in the same country, different regions. And voters and citizens have observed how local, actually administrative office, national government have reacted. So actually, this is also a great way to really try to understand the quality, if you like, of your politician, of your representative. So in that sense also, there is a possibility to actually, and we as Italy, we have experienced a very different reaction from local government. So I would expect that this also may help citizens and voters to have a better accountability of their representatives, because actually we observe a different reaction to a kind of common shock.
I didn't want to give the impression that I'm pessimistic. Usually I'm considered the optimist in the room. I didn't want to give the impression that I consider this moment as a moment of only challenges. I think that, as I mentioned, looking at other cases of emergencies, what one as historians also have done, have noticed is the fact that crises and emergencies create also positive type of feelings, create solidarities, create empowerment. And so I think that's the causal mechanisms that are behind this often and broadening of rights after emergency moment are also related with this empowerment, also related with citizens doing things. So the fact that after the war, there were often enlargement of the rights to vote or even a shift from authoritarian to democratic regimes was also related with this moment of mobilizations, resistance, you have rights and resistance. Now it takes different forms, but what many citizens are doing is sort of resisting to the negative effect of the pandemic. So I think that there is this type of potentials in this moment. And I was reading, I will ask also you later on if you have bibliographical suggestions about the effect of the Spanish flu. But what I have read, written by historians, is that there was already a movement for reforming public health, and the Spanish flu gave a push in that direction because it showed that it was public health was something needed for the societies, but also for the economy, for political support, and so on. So I think that the pandemic are very challenging time, but you have also this potential that I put there as a discursive potential, the idea that something has to be changed and that change need to be radical and fast. On the internet, we had a round table here on what we call blended democracy. So we had addressed the issues of how this strong increase and improvement in digital resources that we also see this afternoon with this possibility to connect and speak online. These are, of course, changes that will remain. My impression, and also the debate we had in this roundtable on blended democracy that was pointing a different type of conceptions of democracy, but also of the blending of online and offline, and digital and on virtual and real and so on, was that there are many things that you can do through internet. And that's here the pandemic has pushed social movements, civil society organizations, as well as normal citizens to improve the capacity to use digital resources, sometimes also to invent new ways of using them. And this has been important, especially for the organizations of many groups, events, actions, all the new mutualist type of forms that I've mentioned have done a lot of their organizing activities online. And this is an area that was studied already before, but we'll need more studies on the digital media and communication and how they improve, especially the organizing capacity of groups that have less resources, like social movements. It was also very useful in knowledge building and knowledge spreading. So there have been also a lot of initiatives oriented towards these elements, creating new knowledge, debating. And for all this, with people skilled in digital technologies, also the capacity of collecting information online and distributing them was extremely relevant. I think where digital technology proved less useful was in putting pressure, because it is true that you can also have learned geolocalized on a place. And it was done, for instance, by Fridays for Future in the period of the deep lockdown. But it doesn't have the same effects in terms of disrupting, becoming visible in public life. And it doesn't have the same effects in terms of capacity to create empathy. So I think that it is true. Now, for instance, we see each other, and it is already better than not seeing each other. But the type of what a colleague called also the smell and the body, the type of empathy that can be created and that social movements need a lot in the squares, through meetings, or also through directly entering in contact with their constituencies, in the case, for instance, of new mutualism, is something that new technologies, I think, cannot substitute to. And I think we also see in our use of the digital technologies that there are some types of tasks that can be performed in a more ecological and easier way online, but not all of them. So I think that for a period, there could even be some backlash. For instance, I was talking with colleagues today and they said, next year, I will not do any Zoom, any Teams, any Meet, and hope this will be over, because it is also, you appreciate the pros, but there are also evident cons.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I totally agree, especially the last part. Me too.
So we are hoping that the students are not too shy and they will ask for...
Please ask questions. Echo.
There's somebody.
I will give.
Yeah. So it's Giacomo.
Be able to speak directly.
Okay. Thanks for the possibility to ask this question, and thanks for the very interesting seminar. So my question is about the quality of the information that circulates, because as you said, a democracy is based on the information, the possibility to discuss them, but clearly in order to get to a goal or to a change, as we said, the information that circulate have to be good and as correct as possible. And like, I was very interested by like a post on Instagram that I saw some days ago, because it was the social media manager that was saying 50% of the comments under, and I just say a name, but I'm not really interested in the name, under Pilon's posts are about people who contest him, but because of them doing so, Pilon's post becomes viral, and so like many more people see it, and like many more And in this way, it gets to many people and it produces effect. So like, and false information can get to, can become true just because they are spread. So as we said, like internet gave us the possibility to get to many people, but just doing so is not a good way to improve democracy, because false information can be spread as well. And just another little question was, and this is very naive, is like, what can we young people do in order to promote this change? Because we talk about volunteering, for example, but clearly if we want a structural change, we need people to direct, and it can, and a structural change, I believe it cannot be based only on volunteering. And so I really thank you for your time and your answers.
Thank you very much for your questions. I think they are very relevant. In terms of the quality of information on the internet, but not only on the internet, I think this completes also the answer to the previous questions. Of course, there are a lot of challenges, but what we see during the pandemic is that the challenge is not only information on the web, that there have been also a lot of bad information spread by newspapers, for instance, because there has been a focus on the most scandalistic news. And sometimes those fake news that may be originated in the internet, but were taken over and spread also by newspapers or by radio channels, television channels. So I think that it is true that the quality of the information declined, but it is not just the internet. I think it's more a use of very aggressive type of use of the internet, connected also with commercializations of the media and decline of the professional capacity of journalism and so on. What can be done? Well, on the web itself, you find a lot of resistance and reactions to this. So there are websites spreading fake news, but there are also websites denouncing the fake news. And this is an important part of this counter knowledge and capacity to communicate that I mentioned. What can people do, young people, but also older people? What we saw in this research is that you start with volunteering, but then many of these initiatives have also addressed politics more in general, so that it is not just a moment in which you develop activity in solidarity with people, but that there is also a reflection during the pandemic about the need of a more structural type of interventions. And then we have to see what will happen, for instance, what will happen in terms of capacity of for instance, political parties to respond. What we saw is that in some countries that were very mobilized before the pandemic, think about Chile, for instance, during the pandemic itself, there have been also deep signs of change. So in Chile, there was a referendum with a huge majority against for changing the constitutions that came from the authoritarian regimes. There have been elections of the citizens that will contribute to writing the new constitutions, and there have been a strong majority by progressive type of organization. So it seems that there is same at local elections. So it seems that there is a potential for this type of activities, initially in solidarities, but to create also broader changes, for instance, through the creation of new parties, the empowerment of other parties. But of course, it's an open.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sorry, there are some problems with Professor Niccolò that was asking. So I hope this won't. Are there any questions?